Council of S.N. Bose National Institute of Basic Sciences, Kolkata, and Chairman of the Research Council of NISPA. He is also Chairman of the Steering Committee for Communicating Scientifically Validated Societal Traditional Knowledge and a guiding force for the National Initiative Swastik. We draw a lot of inspiration from you, sir. So now I request you to kindly deliver the foundation lecture on Indian Traditional Knowledge and Endless Continuum. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Charulata. Dr. Mande, Dr. Ranjana Agarwal, the members of the steering committee of... I have some trouble in sharing my slides.
Go ahead.
So let me add my words of greetings to you all on this day of Makar Sankranti, and also congratulate NISPA team for completing 1 year in this new format. I had the privilege of working with NISPA for about a year or so, and it's indeed a great honor to deliver the first Foundation Day lecture of NISPA. Friends, I'm going to talk about few issues which have fascinated me for many years. Let me begin by saying that the Indian knowledge tradition, it includes almost a broad spectrum, right from philosophy, logic, ethics, literature, linguistics, mathematics, astronomy, Ayurveda and medicinal practices, metallurgy and metallurgical chemistry. And these issues, which are marked in red, we have already taken on board in first communicating to the public. However, there is another shade which we do not discuss much. We also know that India was a rich country before 1772. India's contribution to the world GDP was over 25%. India was the workshop of the world. India had a flourishing international trade, and India had excelled in several fields of technical arts. There is not much documentation available of all these areas, but this and many other aspects have become an integral part of the culture, our culture. So while there is no documentation, we have been practicing this over the last 2,000, 3,000 years at least. So earlier part which I have shown you was known knowns. We know that Indians did great in mathematics, chemistry, and philosophy, and all the astronomy. But these are something which are known unknowns. We know them, only a few people know about it. And this need to be also taken on board in this year in the Swastik activity. And remember that all these issues which I'm going to talk about, they have been responsible for our civilization to flourish for over thousands of years. Now, the Indian mastery over metallurgy has been talked about very often. And this year, last year, we took this on board in the Swastik program, and we have been communicating this. At the same time, we hardly know much. The common people do not know much about the weaving industry in India. And at one point of time, you know that India was a place which was famous for its garments, cloth, textiles, and so on and so forth. In fact, one would say that Indians taught the world how to dress. You can see here the first picture here. This is from the Indus Valley Civilization. And that statue, what you can see, is having that clock, which is made up of cotton. So the weaving started in the Indus Valley Civilization. Another historical proof is that the mummies, which are in the Egyptian tombs, which dated 2000 BCE, they have been found to be wrapped in finest quality Indian muslin. And this cotton the fabric of India was exported to all over India, East and West, and the textile manufacturing was taking place all over India. And from the literature, you feel that the whole country was busy in spinning, weaving, dyeing, printing cotton clothes. Now, I must sensitize you that this particular supremacy of Indian textile was because of the innovations of the Indian weavers. And not much literature is available in the traditional text and manuscripts. However, later, there are some literature available. Now, Indians could produce high quality fabric with exclusive designs. They used the natural and bright dye stuff and large variety of fabric. For example, muslin from Dhaka was of four types: malmal, daria, charkhana, jamdani. And there were 17 types of malmal and 10 types of daria and jamdani. As you can see, just from one place, the variety of fabric was produced. I was also visiting the Imperial Gazetteer of India, Volume 3, and it says that there are 300 fiber-yielding plants in India. Of this, about 100 were more or less regularly used by people, and 10 to 12 were established for the articles of trade. Did we lose all these fiber-yielding plants? This is recorded sometime in 1890 or so. And there were 10 to 12 varieties, the varieties of fibers, which were established as the articles of trade. When I started counting, do I know these 10, 12 varieties? And I could not go beyond three or four. This is the lost knowledge that in the cotton industry. And we also know that the economic protectionism adopted by the British government led to the fall of Indian textile export somewhere in the middle of 19th century. But this is something extremely important. The German economist Friedrich List said, had they sanctioned free importation into England of Indian cotton and silk goods, the English cotton and silk manufacture must of necessity soon come to a stand. India had not only the advantage of cheaper labor and raw material, but also the experience, skill, and the practices of centuries. And this is what we need to take forward and let people know what did we do. Today, we are talking about Make in India. We are talking about Skill India. All these skills which were there in the society for more than 2,000 years, we need to revive this. Another issue which I have also sent some material to Professor Anjana Agarwal is the water management. Indians had excelled in the hydrological, hydraulic, and related science and engineering. And it all started from the Harappan civilization, 3000 to 1580 BCE. And all the big empires in India, they understood the strategic importance of water. So the Mauryan Empire, they are called as the first hydraulic civilization of the world. The Cholas in south, the Kakatiyas in Telangana, and the Maratha Empire in the 17th, 19th century took special interest in the water management. And I have brought to you here some pictures of the traditional water management systems in India. And there are at least 20 traditional water conservation systems. And these are based on a good amount of science, technology, hydraulic, and hydrological engineering. And this is what we need to take forward. And there is very important article published in 2020 on water management in ancient India. I would also talk about the agriculture, but I will not spend much time because when I was preparing these slides, a wonderful book by Dr. A.V. Balasubramanyam, he was kind enough to give me, The Traditional Rice Varieties of Tamil Nadu, a source book. And they have preserved 148 varieties of traditional rice varieties of Tamil Nadu. It's a phenomenal work, and I believe that we should take it forward in our program. Architecture is another issue. And this is, I'm going to spend some time. On the left side, you can see two pictures. The top one is the great monolith at Aksum. This is in Ethiopia. And bottom picture is the temple of Bodhgaya. And if you compare these two pictures, and this was done by James Ferguson in 1891, and what he said, the great monolith at Aksum is of Indian inspiration, the idea Egyptian, but the details Indian. An Indian nine-storied pagoda translated in Egyptian in the first century of Christian era. Its likeness to such Indian temples as Bodh Gaya, it represents, now this is important, it represents that curious marriage of Indian with Egyptian art, which we would expect to find in the spot where the two people came in contact and enlisted architecture to symbolize their commercial union. So not only in India, we have the great architectural monuments, but we also impacted the other places, other cultures in the field of architecture. And there are great many monuments we have. I just brought to you some pictures, the Brihadeshwara temple. Well, if you read the description, then the one in the red font is important. The topmost structure of the temple called Vimana weighs around 80 tons. It is a mystery how the builders got it atop. Now, this is where the science and technology inputs have to come. If we know, if people are still researching on how the great pyramids were constructed, then we should take this problem forward. And also, there are several musical pillars in the temple. What's the science behind this? We need to discover. The Ramappa temple, which was included in the World Heritage Site last year. Now, this provides the kind of technology we had in architecture, the sandbox technology for making the buildings earthquake proof. And they used also the floating brick technology. The normal bricks have a density of 2.2, whereas the bricks used in the Ramappa temple have a density of 0.9. They float on water, and therefore they call the floating brick technology. And these lightweight bricks were used to reduce the load on the entire structure. It's a very important, and our civil engineers need to take it forward, how our ancient Indians were trying to use this sandbox technology or floating brick technology. My another pick is the Chayasameshwara temple. That's 11th century architecture in Nalgonda. Now, why it is called Chayasameshwara is the deity is a Shiva, and there is always a shadow of a pillar on this particular deity. It is Chaya, and therefore it is called Chayasameshwara. But remember, this shadow remains on the deity for all 12 months and from morning till evening. So it does not move. And therefore, it is not a shadow of a pillar of this, any of the pillars in this temple, but it is a phenomena of diffraction of light. And that diffraction of light creates that shadow always on the deity. And if you recall, the diffraction of light was discovered in 1660 by Gilmadi. And this temple is 11th century temple. So the Indians knew about the science of light. They did not write it, but they put it in practice. And this is something which is not known to the people, although people visit this at Chayasameshwara temple. Why I brought this issue, again, I'm echoing with what Professor Mande said. In 2015, the whole world celebrated International Year of Light. And that was to commemorate the book, a work on optics written by Ibn al-Hayyar, that was written in 1050. And this particular book talks about the reflection, refraction, camera obscura. There's a pinhole camera. And we miss that distinction because the science community of India has been unaware of that Chayasameshwara temple, which was built in the same century and had an advanced construct of diffraction. And when it comes to camera obscura, we know this, that there is a pinhole camera at the Virupaksha temple, Hampi. And you can see here, this is the main temple. There is a pinhole in the wall and it creates an inverted image. So this science of light existed. It existed in the form of these buildings. However, we ignored them for quite some time. I also would like to take it forward in the direction of this discussion in the direction of overseas trade. Today, if India, when India is looking forward to become the third largest economy, we must also look at and communicate to the people and also sensitize our youngsters how important works we, our ancient Indians, had done in overseas trade. I'll just bring it to you, a small paragraph from a book by Ellen Churchill. And what it says is, from the dawn of history, in the northern Indian Ocean was a thoroughfare. Along this thoroughfare, Indian colonists, traders and priests carried the elements of Indian civilization to the easternmost Sunda Isle. And Oriental wares, science and religion moved westwards to the margin of Europe and Africa. The Hindus became the dominant commercial nation of the Indian Ocean long before the great development of the Arabian Sea power, and later shared the trade of the East African coast with the merchants of Oman and Yemen. And during this process, a lot of knowledge was acquired on the seafaring. This knowledge does not exist in books, and this is where I said that much of it is in our culture, in our traditions, and also something has got into the folklore. Just to bring you some details, then trading in the northern Indian Ocean, this was called the Erythraean Sea those days. And you can see on the west as well as on the east coast, there were so many ports. They were trading right up to Rome. And there are also incidences noted in the history that someone from Tamil Nadu took a peacock all the way to Rome. How did they do it? It's an interesting story. And you can see in this red is this, this is the Silk Route. When the Silk Route was established, many of the ports on the east of India lost their importance, because from these places, the goods could be taken to the Silk Route. And that is where the Cholas enter in, and they develop the Sea Silk Route. And they established all these colonies here in the east and established these trading routes here. It's extremely important. But at the same time, we should also note what Indians were exporting. And this is what I say, that normally the history tells us that the Indians were exporting spices, the agricultural goods. From my point of view, it's a colonial narrative. The trade could not be just, you cannot survive it only with spices. If you see the articles which Indians were exporting, they were processed goods. We had the industry in this country, the fine quality cotton textiles, silk, steel, metals, metalworks, jewelry, craft, dyestuff, glass beads, paper, cosmetics, perfumes. Even Indians used to export sugar lumps. And in this process, the trade balance was strongly in favor of India. And I have brought to you only three instances. The Pliny the Elder in the first century, he talks about heavy drain of gold from Rome to India. The Portugal in the 16th century lamented that their hard-earned silver from the South American colonies is lost to India. And the British Parliament in the 17th century also expressed similar sentiments. India was, for many centuries, the final depository of a large portion of the gold of the world. And that speaks that this is also, we carry as a tradition, the kind of obsession Indians have for the gold is rooted in its history of great trades. And this all was possible because of the great craftsmanship and techniques that Indians have developed. And there is another piece of history which is known, but we have not promoted it in our class, to our students. our students say that the Vasco da Gama was the first European to arrive in India. Not really. There were considerable colonies of Roman subjects engaged in trade in southern India during the first two centuries. And there are remains of the warehouse, the Roman warehouse in Arkemedu, and that is near Pondicherry. And in fact, the Tamil kings used to employ the soldiers, which were described as a powerful Yavanas and dumb Mlechhas with a complete armor. And they used to act as bodyguards to Tamil kings. While we search the literature, I have brought this something in little more details. There is Sangama literature, which talks about many things which happened in India, and we should take recourse to this. Now, I'm quoting it from R.K. Mukherjee's Indian Shipping, and he is in turn quoting one of the Tamil poets in the Sangama literature. And it talks about the Kaviripaddinam, that's the place, and this is a famous place, Periplus, he refers to it as Kamara, and Ptolemy refers to it as Kavresi. And the description is like this. It was built on the northern bank of the Kaveri River, then a broad and steep stream in which heavy laden ships entered into the sea. There were raised platforms and godowns and warehouses. The goods were stamped with the tiger stamps, which is the emblem of the Chola kings, after payment of custom duty and passed on to the Mlechhas, to the merchants' warehouse. There were also headquarters of foreign traders who had come from beyond the seas and who spoke various languages. And now that whole city, there are all kinds of craftsmen, tradesmen there, vendors of ragged and paste, powders, flowers, incenses, tailors, traders in sandal, agil, coral, grain merchants, washermen, dealers in fish beds, butchers, blacksmiths, braziers, carpenters, coppersmiths, painters. Everybody had their habitation in Maravarapakkam. So this is the kind of flourishing trade that India had at one point of time. We should communicate it to. And this exchange is also has resulted in Greek-Tamil exchange of words. And I've just shown you some examples. And the most interesting which I find is in Tamil, a carpenter is called Thechan, which was taken into Greek as tecton. And that word tecton later on got converted into technology. So the word technology itself has origin in the Indian. Now, we also need to take it to the commerce students, how the trade was organized. It was an organized activity. We were told that it was happening in a random manner. No, the manufacturing and trade were organized activities in India. There were guilds, which were called Nigam or Senio, which were governed by Pramukha or Jethaka. Jethaka is the older man in the community. And these guilds were the centers of skill education and development. And they also acted as bank. So once these guilds got destroyed, the skill education did not continue in this country. And that is where we see that lack of skills, the traditional skills in the country. And there were trades localized in special villages, suburbs, ancillary to the large cities, and themselves forming centers of traffic with surrounding villages. The bazaar, the concept bazaar that we use has originated from this. The trades were regulated, and there was very little government control on the business, and that was only to the extent of royal purchases. It's also important to know what were the industrial classes and the technical skills the Indians possessed. I'm bringing it to you from Dr. Ambedkar's famous writing, Ancient Indian Commerce. The Vaddaki is an industrial class, is a genuine is embodiment of a carpenter, shipbuilder, cart maker, and architect. The description of Kammara is a generic term for a metal craftsman producing iron implements from a plowshare to an axe, for that matter, an iron house down to a razor, or the finest of the needle that is capable of floating in water, or again, the statues of gold and silver work. The Prasanna Kotaka is a generic form of a mason, not only quarrying and shaping stones, but as capable of hollowing a cavity in a crystal, a matter probably of requiring superior tools. In India, we described 64 kalas, and these were arts. And Vatsyayana and Sushruta, they talk about what are these skills, examination and valuation of gold and gems, art of alloying and separating metals, art of extracting alkali, knowledge of coloring gems and jewel, knowledge of mines and quarries, art of piercing and incinerating stones and metals, knowledge of combination of metals, herbs and plants. They're all classified as kalas. These were the skills and trades. This goes on to say how much the ancient Indians valued that skills and trades, because that was that gave rise to such an enormous prosperity to this land. And finally, I'll cover a few things which we have lost totally. The shipbuilding industry in India, and this thriving international trade gave rise to a strong shipbuilding industry. And I'll just bring to you four instances. The Lothal is the world's earliest known dock, about 2000 year BC. Imperial Cholas, they had ships weighing over 75 tons in the 10th century. The Maratha Navy, they had ships over 200 tons in the 17th century. They could build this. And Indian ships built for East India Company, they were in the range of 800 to 1,000 tons in the 18th to 19th century. And one of the directors of the East India Company commented that the ships constructed in India in her heydays were said to be vastly superior to anything built anywhere else in the world. However, the Navigation Act of 1651 and the Discrimination Act of 1814 killed the Indian shipbuilding industry. What we have today are only the maritime history told through the sculptures, printings, and coins. You can see on the left side is the Indian ship, and this is a lead coin, 1st to 2nd century. This is an Ajanta mural depicting an ancient Indian ship with the high stem and the oblong sails attached to three masts. Then the temples in Odisha, the Brihadeshwara temple, Brahmeshwara temple, or Bhogamandapa Puri temple, they have these ships inscribed. And also this terracotta panel at Vishnupur temple, West Bengal. And the most important one is the Borobudur ship. This is the 8th century wooden double outrigger sail vessel depicted in the Borobudur Buddhist monument in central Java. And that is where the naval campaigns by the Cholas, the Sailendran and Sri Vijayan empires, which ruled that region from 7th to 13th century. So we have that rich legacy depicted as sculptures. We should take it forward. And finally, I will talk a little bit about education. When it comes to education, we only talk about the Gurukul system. And in the era of mass education, the Gurukul system is no longer going to be useful to that extent. However, whatever the thoughts of Indians on education, these are extremely important and they have to be practiced. For example, I have brought to you one verse, Acharyat Padamadatte Padam Shishya Swamedhaya Sat Brahmacharibhya Padam Padam Kala Kramenacho. Padam in Sanskrit means 1/4. What it says is that a student learns 1/4 from teacher. Swamedhaya, his own intelligence, he learns 1/4 from own intelligence. Sat Brahmacharibhya Padam, 1/4 from peers, the fellow students. And padam kala kramenacha, 1/4 only with time, that is with practice. Now, today's education philosophy keeps talking about the same thing, that the teacher must engage students in the class, in the discussion. This is because 1/4 is going to come from the peers, and 1/4 is with time, with the practice. We have forgotten this. And today, when we talk about the massive open online courses, the MOOCs, they adopt this strategy. The MOOCs have got 4 parts: the learning dialogues, learning by doing, learning extension trajectories, and learner experience interaction. What does it mean? This part is a content, that is the actual lecture, this responsibility of teacher, activities and exercises, column, that is for the practice, then resource and assimilation quiz, that is for increasing students' intelligence, and have focus questions on discussions, peer interaction, and reflection quizzes. And this is all is that 1/4 from peer, 1/4 from teacher, 1/4 with practice, and 1/4 from our own intelligence. This particular extremely important thought has to get into. I'll bring just one more example. The National Education Policy talks about the critical thinking and problem solving abilities and so on and so forth. Now, here is a dialogue between Narad and Sanat Kumar from Chandogya Upanishad. And the story goes like this, that Narada requests Sanat Kumar to teach him something. And Sanat Kumar asks a question, "What have you learned so far?" And then Narada says, "I have learned Rigveda, Bhagavad, Yami, Yajurvedam, Samaveda, Chaturmidhi, Purana, Itihasa Purana, Panchama Vedani. I have learned everything." And then Sanat Kumar says, "These are all names. You have not told me what you have learned." So this is like asking a student of today, "What have you learned?" And he says, "Physics, chemistry, maths, biology, history." Then you say, "Oh, it's all names. What did you learn?" And then it goes on, the dialogue goes on. The speech is superior to name. Mind is superior to speech. The will is superior to mind. Intelligence, this is the way one has to go forward in learning. And finally, you can also see meditation is superior to intelligence, and vijnana, the practical application of knowledge, is superior to meditation. Also important, which you have forgotten, is the informal layer of Indian education system. And that came through the Panchatantra, Hitopadesha, and Jatakatha. In the formal education system, whatever the gaps, those gaps were filled through this nice stories. And these stories became so popular. The Panchatantra itself means interweaving 5 kinds of traditions and teaching into a text. This was written about 300 BCE. It reached Persia in the 6th century, reached Europe in 11th century. It's the most translated Indian work, 200 versions in over 50 languages. And I'll just bring just one example. You must have read this story, the 4 Brahmins and a dead lion in the Panchatantra. And what does this story tell you? How and when to use or not to use your knowledge. In the formal education, you gain knowledge, but you may not gain that idea when or when not to use the knowledge. And this was given through that Panchatantra story. This informal layer of ancient Indian education system, we have lost totally. And this is this teaching ideas, the teaching philosophy, created those great universities which we talk about. It was knowledge and the teaching methods and teaching philosophies. And Takshashila, Nalanda, Vikramsinha, Vallabhi, Nagarjuna, Jagadalla, and all these universities, they became the centers of knowledge, centers of teaching, because of the great knowledge and the skills that the Indian society had. At the same time, there were great teaching methods developed in this country. I'll end it. Just when I was making these slides, my attention was brought by Mr. Kenneth, who was a former director of the Nehru Science Center in Mumbai, on the science and civilization in China. This is edited by Joseph Needham, Cambridge University Press. It's published from 1954 till date. These are compilation of what was science and civilization in China. And you can see the volume for physics and physical technology. It is in three parts. India also had a great chemistry and chemical technology. Chinese have written volume 5, which has got 13 parts. And then biology and biological technology. There are volume 6, which is at part 1 and 6. So at the end of this presentation, I would ask just two questions. Can we envisage doing this? That we have the literature, but there are one article here, one article there. Can we have such a compilation where the science of this country, what was developed in the ancient times, can be put forward? And the second question that I would raise, that so many skills we have, I could touch only a few because of the time factor. Can we reconstruct our lost skills? Can we reconstruct the Malmal of Dhaka? Can we reconstruct the steel technologies, which were the boot steel technology? Can we do this? And this is where the all the people, the science, technology, history, architect, archaeologist, everybody had to come together. There is no point in saying that our temples are great, have great architecture, but we must unearth the physics behind it and take it forward. With these words, I close here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for your wonderful talk, which I'm sure has enlightened the audience about our glorious heritage of traditional knowledge and practices that span several S&T domains. And I assure you that Team Swastik will definitely give its best to communicate India's scientifically validated traditional knowledge and sensitize different sections of the society regarding our glorious traditional knowledge and our glorious heritage. So thank you very much, sir. So now I request Dr. Paramananda to propose the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Professor Chakta, for enlightening us on our rich traditional heritage on this auspicious occasion of Makar Sankranti and our Foundation Day. The NISPA family is grateful to DGCSR Dr. Sekhar Shi Mande for gracing this occasion and always guiding us. Grateful to Dr. Nisha Mandrita, Dr. Madhu Dixit, Dr. Prabodh Kumar Trivedi, Dr. Anjan Ray, Dr. Biswajanani, different directors from different CSR labs, and our distinguished guest for joining this occasion and gracing us. We're grateful to Dr. Director CSR NISPR, Dr. Ranjana Agarwal, ma'am, for planning this event and then guiding us to coordinate this one. We're grateful to the organizing committee, CSR NISPR family, media persons, distinguished guests, and the team Swastik for joining and then taking part in the celebration of CSR NISPR Foundation Day. So, overall, the whole NISPA family is grateful to everyone for blessing us on this auspicious occasion of Makar Sankranti and our Foundation Day. We wish you all a very happy Makar Sankranti and a happy New Year. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Jagta, Professor Anjan Ray, Professor Trivedi, Professor Dixit, Dr. Biswajanani, and I could see our CVO also joined. Thank you so very much. And thanks, Team CSI and NISPR. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. So with all the inspirations taken today, the session comes to an end. And now I request Team Swastik and other steering committee members of Swastik to join the following meeting. Thank you very much.
Charu, it's a different link, no?
Yes, ma'am, it's a different link.
Thank you.